music. And, yeah.
No, so there is a large one here. This is a...
Well, good evening, everybody. Thanks for coming out on a Tuesday night. And I'm very excited to be showing this film tonight, and also to have Dr. Don Burig join us about 8 o'clock this evening. So our journey continues in this community to try to improve the health and well-being. And I think that this movie tonight will hopefully bring some questions and hopefully some solutions in terms of addressing what we really need to do to become individually healthy and also healthy as a community. I think that we are in a time of healthcare that is a lot of uncertainty. And I think it's becoming almost by each year, there's more and more uncertainty how things are going to change. But we need to realize that some of the things that we need to do can't just be done through pills and procedures, and that we have to recognize that a healthy lifestyle and living in balance is one of the most important things that we can do, not only for ourselves, but for our kids and for our community. Today's film, Escape Fire, The Fight to Rescue American Healthcare, is not going to necessarily paint a completely rosy picture of where we are as a nation in terms of what our healthcare currently is. But we can change, and we will change, and transform what we are doing. We can learn from other countries. We can learn from already many things that are already available, but we have to get behind those things and recognize that we have to reach out to one another and connect. So we're going to show Escape Fire. It's about a 90-minute film, and we really are very fortunate to have Don Burig join us afterwards. And I'll introduce Don in more detail when he arrives, but he really is a global force for improving healthcare. So we're going to start the film. Thank you for coming. And you know, the idea is, after this film, is anything that you learn from that is to share with others. For healthcare providers, if you go to the Escape Fire website, there's CME credits for nurses, doctors, and I believe there's several other healthcare professionals. If you go on their website, you can get CME credits for tonight as well. Let's enjoy the film.
In 1949, a forest fire broke out in Man Gulch, Montana. Smoke jumpers perishing, a team of 15 hit by a foreman named Wag Dodge. The fire exploded, was moving over 600 feet a minute, faster than most people could ever run, and so 15 firefighters were trapped. Wag Dodge had an idea. He knew that they would lose the race back to the top of the ridge, so he suddenly stopped, he lit a match, and he lit a fire at his own feet. Fire spread around him. I imagine the other smoke jumpers thought the guy was crazy, but his idea was this: if I burn the fuel around me, then when the fire comes and overtakes me, I'm safe. I'll be in what came to be known as an escape fire. He tried to get the other smoke jumpers to join him, and nobody did. The fire overtook the crew, killing 13 men and burning 3,200 acres. Wag Dodge survived, nearly unharmed, in his escape fire. It's just tragic to think of the answer being there, but just in the moment, not able to see it. That's how embedded people get in the status quo. They can't recognize an invention when it's among them, and they can't give up their old habits. We're in Man Gulch. Healthcare gets headed for really, really bad trouble. The answer is among us. Can we please stop and think and make sense of the situation and get our way out of it? It's the same challenge.
We have had enough! Enough! What do we want?
Healthcare!
What do we want?
Now!
All I hear is how we're going to
to give more people access to the present system and how we're going to pay for it. And to me, that's not the only issue. The present system doesn't work, and it's going to take us down. We need a whole new kind of medicine.
Healthcare reform was a good place to start,
but it will do little to address the root problems. We don't have a healthcare system in this country. We have a disease management system.
People often think it has to be a new drug or a new laser or something really high-tech and expensive to be powerful. And they have a hard time believing that these simple choices that we make in our lives each day can make such a powerful difference.
We're in the grip of a very big industry, and it doesn't want to stop making money.
At the executive level, what's most important is meeting Wall Street's expectations. And they have to. These for-profit companies, by law, have to serve shareholders. You almost forget that what you're doing is providing healthcare.
The healthcare system is unsustainable. We're spending almost twice as much in America as any other country on Earth. We're really mortgaging the future. Not just the health of healthcare, we're talking about the health of the nation.
Scissors?
Yeah.
I started getting sick in my 30s. I started having really, really bad chest pain.
Here we go, a flower for you.
Oh, it's so beautiful. I just had been ignoring it because I thought, you know, I'm only 34 years old. I can't be having heart problems. But one evening, I sat straight up in bed with the worst chest pain. So I went into the hospital, and they told me I'd had a heart attack. I was 35 at the time and was scheduled for open heart surgery. And I thought, once I get this, I won't have the blockages anymore. You know, they'll actually fix it. Little did I know that it was followed by years of the same thing over and over and over again. A heart cath, get another stent. Heart cath, get another stent. Until my doctor said to me, I don't know what else to do for you. There's nothing else I can do.
Contrary to what most people believe, getting a stent in your coronary, if you have stable chest pain, will likely relieve your pain, but it will not help you live longer, and it will not protect you from having a heart attack. It only reduces symptoms. And the problem is that some of those procedures will lead to bad outcomes.
I'd started doing research about where in the United States do I have to go to get the best heart care. And ironically, it was only 2 hours away at the Cleveland Clinic.
How are you?
I am great. Look at the thinness.
I know, you look really good.
I have lost, since last year, I've lost 21 pounds.
Oh my God. Yvonne came to see me when she was sort of at her wit's end. She had had bypass surgery at an early age, 27 cardiac catheterizations, and well over 7 stents.
Deep breath.
This is just an unbelievable amount of stents and cardiac caths.
I'm sorry, it's gonna get pretty tight, huh?
Oh, I'm sorry. I can't tell you how shocked we were when we saw her the first time. Because here was a young woman whose diabetes was not well controlled, her cholesterol was never well controlled, and her high blood pressure was never well controlled.
Were you normally for me?
If someone had talked to her, I think someone had really teased out her chest pain and her shortness of breath, I think many of her cardiac catheterization and stents would not have been necessary. You know, you have all these stents, and you know, these stents, once they go in, they never come out, and they're part of you. Now we're kind of dealing with the consequences. When you reward physicians for doing procedures instead of talking to patients, that's what they're gonna do, is do procedures.
The vast majority of doctors in this country are paid by a fee-for-service system. And that simply means that they get paid for each office visit. If they're surgeons, they get paid for each procedure. If it's a radiologist, they get paid for each CT scan that they deliver.
If I spend 5 minutes with you and then put in one of these stents, I'd probably get paid $1,500. For me to spend 45 minutes on an established visit with a patient to make sure they're doing their exercise, make sure their diabetes is going okay, and to try to figure out what their true problem is, probably get paid $15. It's a completely irrational system.
Fee-for-service rewards physicians for doing more. It doesn't reward them for doing a better job. It doesn't reward them for keeping their patients healthy. It rewards them for delivering more care.
I was trying to figure out how much Yvonne's care would have been over the years, and I think it's well over 1.5 million. But it's more than cost. It's just so much more than money. The psychological trauma of every one of those multiple cardiac catheterization, every time she had a chest pain, coming into the ER. And unfortunately, there are lots of Yvonne's out there.
Although we've made progress technologically, you know, we know how to do things for diseases we couldn't have done before, we haven't really experienced the systemic improvement that we want, the new healthcare system that we're really after. We pay for fragments of care, a doctor visit, a hospital stay, a lab test, an ambulance trip. So because we pay for pieces, we get pieces. And so people who really need a coordinated system, they don't get that.
Medicine is very siloed. Medicine is very specialized. And this is really a big problem when you go to the hospital, because there are so many different people who lay their hands on you. And if they're not talking to each other, you can't necessarily get the right diagnosis. You can get repeated tests. You can get things happening to you that put you in harm's way, because nobody's really keeping track of you as an individual patient. A recent study found that 187,000 patients die each year from harmful care in the hospital, which includes medical errors and deadly infections. Based on these numbers, this would be the third leading cause of death in the United States, just after heart disease and cancer.
Dr. Ross, I am back in the chest pain center with a pretty sick patient, and I'm gonna need you to call attending phone too.
The emergency department is the safety net of healthcare. We see a lot of the chronic conditions that affect many Americans that have gone untreated for sometimes months, but sometimes years. And of course, the natural endpoint is going to be in the emergency department.
Let me just take a listen to you.
It would be so wonderful if their chronic health conditions could be prevented through effective primary care.
There's a saying in healthcare policy that 20% of the patients account for 80% of the costs. And the majority of those costs are when they're repeatedly hospitalized. They're patients with heart failure, they're morbidly obese patients, they are often poor patients, but not always. One of the ways to think about saving money in healthcare is to focus our energies on that 20% of patients and think about treating those people in a more effective way.
I just want to review this pain. It's right here, there, right, yes, in the center
right
of your chest.
Yes,
okay.
Ma'am.
And is it still traveling into
it's
traveling your neck?
Traveling down my arm, my neck, and my head and ears buzzing and ringing.
Okay.
Same time.
What was it, Mr. Litton, that finally made you say, okay, that's it, I'm going to the emergency department
well,
now?
See, I've been to the emergency department a few times before. And the last time I was having chest pains, not like this, it's uh-huh. a lot worse. They sent me home with them.
How long ago was that?
That was, what, a month and a half ago? When I had my first heart attack, I did the cardiac catheterization, you know, put the thing up there and then put a stent in my heart because I had a clogged artery. And that worked for a while. I mean, a couple weeks, I felt like I was okay. And then all of a sudden, I started getting chest pains again. So here I am going in and out of hospital to find out what's going on.
Do you have any eating habits that you think
might be? No, I eat the regular food and stuff.
What's regular food?
Eggs, sausage, grits, bacon.
Well, what do you think about your diet?
Heart healthy diet?
Yeah. What do you think about that?
I'd do it if I had to. But, you know.
If you had to? Well, you have a stent in your heart, right?
Yeah.
All right. And you've had heart attacks. And you're here today with chest pain.
Yeah.
When do you think it would be good to try it?
Once I found out what's really wrong with me.
We've become a culture where you drive up, you get what you want, you get it fast, you get it right away, and you drive off. And that being applied to healthcare just doesn't work. Most diseases don't happen overnight. Sometimes they're related to lifestyle habits. Sometimes it's related to what the individuals actually have access to.
I have no health insurance. Sometimes I go to the hospital, and that's the only health care I ever got. I never had a personal doctor, family doctor, nothing, all my life. I stopped taking my medicine months ago because it's too much, can't afford it. If you go out and buy heart-healthy diet food, it's gonna cost you more money than anything.
Probably get paid $1,500. For me to spend 45 minutes with a patient to try to figure out what their true problem is, probably get paid $15. It's a completely irrational system.
We don't have a healthcare system in this country. We have a disease management system.
We're spending almost twice as much in America as any other country on earth, but our lifespan isn't even in the top 20.
30,000 Medicare recipients die each year from care they didn't need.
That's the equivalent of a jumbo jet crashing every single week. If the aviation industry killed as many people, we'd be up in arms.
How many patients you see?
All right, who's next? If you try and buck the system, someone says, "What can we do to get your productivity up?" I'm not interested in getting my productivity up. I'm interested in helping patients.
Soldiers' use of prescription drugs has tripled in the past 5 years.
This medication's I was on.
Accepting that the American healthcare system is badly broken, will we be able to seek out the escape fires, the potential solutions? There are answers.
One company has figured out how to lower healthcare costs by more than 40%.
We provide incentives for people to engage in healthier behaviors.
The Army Surgeon General directed that we establish the Pain Management Task Force to take a look at alternatives to narcotics.
I was skeptical, so skeptical.
I've gotten a lot of inspiration, a different perspective. There's a different way of doing things that is possible.
If I think about what healthcare could be like, it would have a lot more care in it.
Mortgaging the future, not just the health of healthcare, we're talking about the health of the nation.
So if everybody wants to get up for 1 second and just stretch forward and sit.
Oh my God.
It's with great pleasure today that I have the opportunity to welcome Dr. Don Berwick to join us, who was obviously a tremendous influence on this film and is a lead authority on healthcare quality and improvement. Dr. Berwick is a graduate of Harvard Medical School in 1972. He's clinical professor of pediatrics and healthcare policy at Harvard School of Medicine. He's the President Emeritus and Senior Fellow of the Institute of Healthcare Improvement, the former Administrator of the Centers of Medicare and Medicaid Services under President Obama in 2010. He's also on the Advisory Commission for President Clinton on Consumer Protection, Quality, and Healthcare Industry. He's one of the global movers and shakers to help all of us across the world improve our healthcare. He's put forth such important ideas as the triple aim: better care, better health for the population at lower cost. He consistently is asking himself and everyone, how does it help the patient? And making sure that healthcare is a human right. He's fighting for all of us out there, we the people of the United States. And if anybody's had an opportunity to listen to him speak or had an opportunity to read any of the speeches, which I've had the privilege of reading two of his books, he is, without question, a man of great depth and cares deeply for the health of our nation, Dr. Don Berwick.
Thanks so much, Mike. When I got asked to join you here this evening, I really appreciated the invitation. As Mike did not mention, I ran for governor, as you know, the last 2 years, and I remember every single trip to New Bedford. This place stole my heart. There's something about this city that is really special to me, and the chance to talk with you about the issues I care about, which is healthy communities and vitality and lives, I just couldn't pass it up. So thanks for letting me come down here and spend time with you. You've got a lot of stamina. You've been through a long film, and I probably have people to see at home and a snack to have and maybe bedtime. So I don't want to take too long. I did not bring slides or a speech. What I think what I'd like to do is just open the floor to you. You've just seen a provocative film that was made a couple years ago by a brilliant young filmmaker, Matt Heineman, that I had the privilege to help him with. What you may not know is that film went to the Sundance Film Festival. So I had the opportunity to rub elbows with people at the Sundance Film Festival because they brought the cast of the film there. It was really cool. And it did stimulate some conversation around the U.S. That conversation is not over at all. But I'd love to know what this means to you. I said in the film what I think, which is that we're nowhere near a healthcare system in America and in Massachusetts that is really configured to help us achieve what we want, which is long and vital lives and communities that work. The problems are very large. Mike mentioned the triple aim. That came from my old organization where I'm back now as a senior fellow, the Institute for Healthcare Improvement. It said if we really got our act together and were able to take even a fraction of the 18% of our gross domestic product we put into healthcare and oriented around what we needed, what we would want is great care if we're sick, better care, better experience of care if you're an individual, better health so you don't need the care in the first place, and lower per capita costs so we have the money to do other things with. I said in the film, and I believe this system is really broken. It doesn't achieve that. The efforts of doctors and nurses and hospitals, they're brilliant. These people are trying really hard to do the right thing, but they're trapped in a system that was built in kind of in the wrong direction, at least the wrong direction for our time. On better care, we have tremendous scientific evidence, overwhelming evidence of pervasive problems in care around patient safety. People get hurt in care with injuries that are avoidable if we design the systems better. We have problems around effectiveness. People don't get the care they really need, and they get a lot of the care they don't need. We don't apply care with science. We have problems around patient-centeredness. The system kind of asks you when you come in to accommodate to it instead of accommodating to you. And so if your language is different, or your values are different, or your wishes are different, this healthcare system doesn't really ask you what matters to you. It asks what's the matter with you, and then acts on you. We have problems with timeliness. There are delays throughout our system that especially affect people of color and people in disadvantaged communities. We have problems in efficiency. There's tremendous amounts of waste, which I can talk with you about if you want. We have problems in equity. The biggest predictor of your lifespan in America still, of your health status, is your race. It's still true. And your wealth. It's not what disease you have, it's the conditions in which you were born, and that's a quality problem. That's just the experience of care. If you go upstream to why you're in the hospital, the things that make us sick, the things that explain variation in your health, 50% of it is genes. It's just, it's what you inherited. You can't control that. You can adapt to it, but you can't control it. The other 50% of variation in your health, just 10% of that is health care. The big determinant of health is a whole bunch of a list of other things that aren't healthcare, like how you exercise patterns and physical activity, what you eat, substance abuse, and what you put into your body, threats from the environment and the air, poverty and injustice. These are what make you healthy. You're not 400% more powerful than healthcare, yet the system invests 18% of our gross domestic product in that little 10% instead of broadening what we're trying to affect. So you actually don't have to have your heart attack, you don't have to have your stroke, you don't have to be depressed. We can work on those, but not always through healthcare by any means. And then lower per capita cost has to do with where we are. We're 18% of our GDP in healthcare. The next most expensive country is at 12. And we have no evidence at all that that difference in what we're spending actually produces anything in our healthcare system. I'll give you the figure. The second most expensive country is Switzerland over the past 30 years. If American healthcare had tracked the Swiss expenditure over the past 30 years instead of the American expenditure, this country would have spent $15.5 trillion less on healthcare. Just that difference between us and Switzerland. And if you look at the results, Switzerland is number 2 in the world in ratings of its healthcare system. We're number 37. Switzerland has the second longest life expectancy in the world. We have the 40th. So we're not getting value for that gap. And that money's coming from your pockets. It's all your money. It's all your money. It's all, the only source of that money is wages. And that denies you as private individuals the chance to go out to dinner tonight or send your kids to college. As running the county for governor, I saw the effect on the state budget. This state has cut everything in the past 15 years. Local aid's down 40%. Higher education, state-supported higher education is down 30%. Parks and recreation is down 25%. Everything's down except one item. That's health care, state purchase of health care through GIC and Medicaid. That's up 72%. So you have this confiscation going on of your opportunities as citizens and private individuals to take the money and put it into roads and schools and making the bed for the vibrant community you want it to be, because the money's being drawn off into healthcare, which would be fine with me if healthcare needed all that money, but it really doesn't. And if we built the system properly, or now rebuilt it, we could have a different result. What excites me about communities that get interested in this, take New Bedford, it's possible these changes could occur at the community level. A vision of a really vibrant New Bedford, the one you really want it to be, where people don't experience the risks they feel, where health is the centering idea in the community, where the hospital is the last place you want to be, not the first place if you're sick, where there's a focus on reducing the overuse and the waste of care that doesn't help anybody at all. In fact, it hurts you. We're not going to do that nationally. It's too politically fraught right now. We're headed sort of that way, but it's just you can't get stuff done. At the state level, I won't comment on that, but you know, it depends on state leadership. But even while all that's happening, the communities, I think, can act, and that excites me. So that's enough of a preamble. If you want to ask a few questions, ask away. I'm happy to deal with anything you saw in the film. I'm thrilled to be able to talk to you. Yes, ma'am, in the white in the back.
Dr. Berwick, I'd like to ask you, what did you learn from your administrative role at CMS?
Thanks. What did I learn from my administrative role at CMS? Well, I went to CMS because I was asked to. The president asked me to take on this enormous job. I didn't seek it, and I was kind of scared, and it was a big bureaucracy, and people said, why are you doing that? You'll get eaten alive by the bureaucracy. Oh, no. I learned so much about what a positive government role can be. I mean, at CMS, it's a single payer. We have one payer for 100 million Americans, or Medicare and Medicaid, 50 million Medicare beneficiaries, 50 million Medicaid beneficiaries. And because it's government, publicly accountable, with lots of transparency, I could do things running that agency, 5,500 people, $820 billion budget, and think about the interests of the people. For example, we got evidence from the Inspector General that in nursing homes, over sedation was being used, people were in chemical restraints, which is not a good idea. Those people are placed at great risk. Because I was where I was, I could take that report, call in the geriatric community, the nursing home community, literally in my office, and say, 300,000 people in chemical restraints, you stop it or we'll stop it. So get to work. And they did, and there's now, 4 years later, a big national project to reduce overuse of sedatives. What you're seeing there is government in the right role, speaking, making accountability occur for the public at large. We really could invest in that kind of defense of public, of common interest. Government also has information. Try to get information from your insurance company about patterns of use of care or quality of care or changes in innovations. They're not, they're competitive small or large companies, but their business models aren't sharing. Government, by statute, we had to turn the lights on, share the data, show people what's going on, offer researchers the opportunity to use data responsibly so we could be a supplier of a lot of learning, and we could lead change. So for example, I got to set up the Center for Medicare and Medicaid Innovation with a $10 billion part of the Affordable Care Act. The first or second project I established in that center was a $1 billion program in America to make healthcare safer called the Partnership for Patients. We targeted unnecessary readmissions to hospitals and injuries that you get in hospitals, like getting the wrong medicine or getting an infection that the hospital gave you or having surgery done in the wrong place. We targeted those, but we invested in helping hospitals learn how to make their care safer with very large networks in this country, all supported by government. And the results are very good. We have a 17%, we have the lowest rate of readmission in the history of the data. We've substantially reduced hospital-based infections, pressure ulcers, medication errors. All of this is documented in the research that followed that. That's public sector investment in the well-being of the public. The other thing I must say is I learned how good the government workforce is. It's kind of like you're supposed to criticize the bureaucrats in government. Let me tell you, 5,500 employees in Medicare, most of them coming to work for their careers to figure out how to do public service. They need leadership. They need someone to call them to their mission. But they were really ready to do it, and I frankly think that's true in state government. Those are some of the lessons. It infected me enough in my hope for government that I want to be governor, because I think with proper leadership at this state level, with 7 million people and this aggregate where we kind of can visit each other, you probably can get things done you couldn't get done nationally. It's a long answer, but that's some of what I learned. Yes, ma'am.
I really enjoyed the film, and it was inspiring to see that change is being made. I just wonder how you work with a government that is still continues to subsidize corn and sugar, and that seems to be a big problem.
Well, you know, the question was how can you work, given that we're providing subsidies for corn and sugar? You could list a whole bunch of other anomalies in the way we support nutrition in the case. This is a couple things. First, it's an underinvestment in the health of the public. I mean, we consume corn and sugar partly because we don't, as a public, understand how much control we actually have over our health. Let me give you an example. The difference between an obese child, who's going to be an obese adult, who's going to have diabetes and problems with blood pressure and a shorter life, and a non-obese child who stands a chance of avoiding that, is one can of Coke a day. If we could reduce the intake of a child of soft drinks by one can, you overcome child obesity. That's in our control. So you could blame the food industry and the subsidies, but let's notice that we don't have an investment as a public in understanding what a truly healthy environment would be. I give you a little quiz. I know a drug that has the following effect. It appears to reduce the risk of heart disease by 50%, reduces the risk of breast cancer almost 50%. It's the best known treatment for depression, and it has no side effects at all. Do you know what it is?
Exercise.
It's walking, yeah, exercise. 20 minutes a day of walking, 4 times a week, has all the effects I just told you. New Bedford could be the healthiest community in the nation, but we have to understand that and then somehow build a sense in the community that it's a different way to be. And it's not social control, it's taking control of yourself. There's a wonderful program that I just ran into in Scotland, in Stirling, Scotland, the St. Ninian School, it's an elementary school, where they had 45% of the kids were overweight, and they just got fed up with that. And they started a program there, which it took them 4 months. They introduced a program called the Daily Mile. Every kid in that elementary school and every teacher now runs 1 mile a day. The level of obesity in the St. Ninian School for 450 kids in Scotland is zero. And they did it not by political maneuvering, they did it by taking control. The other part of your question, though, is lobbying. I mean, we are in a country where big money controls so much of what we do. And I could see it in Medicare. Try to push back against medical devices that don't hurt, don't help at all, or push back against insane pharmaceutical pricing, and you will get a call from a senator who says, you're fiddling with something in my district, back off, and that money is coming through the lobbying. And until we have public financing campaigns, a lot of what you'd like to see happen can. Yes?
Still, there's the, and it's, I know it's complicated, but the healthcare system that we have now is very problematic, and it seems to me that it's heading in a worse direction than better at the moment. We don't have time to talk about why I think that, but what can an individual do, for example, when she goes to see her primary care physician? What's one of the best things that an individual can do? Ask of her primary care physician and expect of the relationship that she has with that primary care physician.
Yeah. Are you, do you work in healthcare now? Are you,
no, no.
It's a wonderful question. You know, we're now focusing on the healthcare part. What can you do? There isn't a simple answer. I'll give you some things that I think help. I'm struck as a doctor and as a student of improvement at how passive we've been taught to be as patients. Do you really know the names of the medicines you're on? Have you looked up what their side effects are? When the doctor told you your diagnosis, did you listen and write it down and understand it, or did you give up and say, you know, he's smart, I'm not, I'm going to leave? When you went to see the doctor, were you prepared with the questions you really wanted the answers to? There's an activist role that you're probably pretty comfortable with in a lot of your commercial life. Bring it to healthcare. Speak up. If you don't understand, it's not because you're not smart. It's because they didn't explain it well enough yet. And take control of the knowledge. I personally believe, by the way, that one of the things we've got to get to in this country is everyone has their own medical record. Legally, you're entitled to it. It's very hard to get it, but why not make New Bedford the first place where it's just expected you have your record in your hands and all the doctors and hospitals know that so you can read it and understand it. Another is, it's bring someone with you. It's advice I hate to give because it really is a cover, it's a band-aid over the system's inability to slow down and focus on you. But whenever anyone is ill, feeling bad or in a bed and wants more protection, more control, my advice is probably have someone with you. You're busy being sick, and it may be that a loved one needs to be there making the inquiries, making the notes, being a little bit edgy where you don't have the energy to do that. Those are some ideas, but it's tough. If you happen to be on the board of a hospital, which public citizens are, or you're in a governance role, use that platform. You have a chance. It's not a seat of honor, it's a seat of responsibility. Take what you learned in this film to your role in a governance position. That will help a lot.
Thank you.
Yes?
Dr. To the quadruple aim of taking care of the providers that provide the care.
Great. Yeah, I wrote the journal aim paper in 2006, and so no matter whether we want to make a quadruple aim or not, there is a fourth goal, and that is joy in work. You cannot get excellence in a service industry, make a hotel or a restaurant, if the workforce is demoralized, doesn't have a feeling that the work is adding meaning to their lives, or that they have their, get the support they want, or they're treated with dignity. And right now we have a healthcare workforce in the country that's in pretty rough shape, that people are feeling quite helpless. They feel watched instead of trusted, not, you know, by the government, but and by patients. And it's a very rough spot for nurses, doctors, and other health professionals. So one of my goals definitely is would be reestablishing joy in work. The triple aim was framed as a social need. You know, it's what does healthcare need to produce for society, not everything that should be done. But we can't get there without focusing back on pride in the professions. Now, how do we get there? Partly it has to do with rebalancing payment, because a lot of that demoralization is occurring in the primary care doctor and the primary care nurse, who really is the first person who's trying to organize what you really need. And those people are getting, they're not paid as much, they're not supported as much, they don't have as much prestige, and there's a rebalancing toward the primary care system that I think is absolutely crucial. Another issue is the use of data. I personally believe that we're using information in healthcare now more and more, but to beat up on the workforce, to you know, decide if they're good or bad, reward the good ones, punish the bad ones. Well, when I go to work to see a patient, or used to, you'd be misunderstanding if you thought it mattered to me if you paid me $10 extra to try harder. You have no idea what's in my brain. You don't understand me. And nor would you understand most doctors and nurses. They're trying hard to do the right thing, most of them. And this whole emphasis on pay for performance and public disclosure and accountability, it's kind of wrong-headed. We need to have a healthcare system that's much more oriented around learning and growth and development. And by the way, just for the record, that's what I feel about teachers. I think the teachers, somehow we bought this message that our carrots and sticks are the tools of management. No. Learning is a tool of management. Respect, joy, love, those are tools of management where we can actually get together and do things. And leaders who know that get much better. There's much better performance in those organizations. So that's some of it. But to your point, joy in work in healthcare needs to be a fundamental goal. Yes, sir.
This is just a couple of comments. I'm a firm believer you have to be your own best health advocate. The thing that concerns me when I watch the nightly news, I see all these commercials, these pharmacy commercials. I would love to see a public service announcement where someone just talked about plants, how much better plants are for you. The other thing is diabetes. We have addiction treatment centers for drugs, but nothing for the standard American diet, SAD diet. And there's a lot of inner city people who don't have access to produce, fresh produce. So I think that's a big problem. And I guess I have a father who has diabetes, and I really feel like if he wouldn't have gotten to a certain point if he would have changed his diet. And one of the things is a 30-day detox on plants, just plants, versus junk.
We know a ton about proper nutrition that you're going at. Let me tell you a little bit of fact. This relates to one thing that I care deeply about, which is poverty. In my campaign, we had all the staff took the SNAP challenge, that is, we all ate only the amount of food you could buy with the value of food stamps, which was $32 a day, I think, a week, I believe it was. It was, yeah, six, something like $6 or $7 a day, I can't remember the exact amount. We all gained weight, because the only food you can afford were high-calorie carbohydrates or highly processed foods, fresh vegetables. I couldn't afford a head of lettuce or a bunch of carrots. That would have been my whole allocation. So we got that really wrong. This is partly a matter of knowledge, people really understanding, like the film is getting to, about the things that make us, that can actually make us healthier, and that knowledge is not widespread. What happens in public policy, back to your question about sugars, so in the Affordable Care Act, Obamacare, there is a very rich law. There are many different parts of it, but there's several titles of it are focused on prevention, and some of those titles funded national prevention accounts that CDC and other agencies could use to help with what you're what you're talking about. When Congress had at the Affordable Care Act and began cutting back on the ability to implement it, which explained a lot of the troubles, the first thing that went out was the prevention funds. Those got slashed because they have the least political support. You don't go on the streets when you don't get educated about proper nutrition. You do go on the streets if you can't get access to your doctor. So the politics of prevention are not solid. Again, you're asking about what you can do as a public, you know, New Bedford as a community. Figure it out. Start to understand what staying healthy really looks like, and it's the results are phenomenal when you go in that direction. There was someone here. Yes, ma'am. Yeah.
I just want to underscore your point about the teachers and the doctors and so on. The systems right now in this country are all sort of collapsing. The infrastructure of the country, the schools. You mentioned that school earlier, where kids get to exercise. We've got schools in New Bedford where going out to play or something is not considered time on learning because of the testing. The whole thing is completely sick and corroded. And I'd just like to recommend a book for people to read, which takes every system in this country and talks about how it could be improved. And the name of that book is Imagine Living in a Socialist USA. And it's a compendium of chapters by people in different fields, every system in this country, looking at how easily, as you said, we could change it if our priorities were right. And we didn't have this prejudice that's been created by the big money people who don't want to spread the wealth and spread the good health and the good education.
Yeah, I don't want to be glib about it, but
excellent book.
What's it called again? What would it be like to live in a
socialist?
Yeah, a word that kept occurring to me campaigning and listening to you in your living rooms is used in Europe, but it's not used in the U.S., and that's solidarity. There's a lot of power in feeling the power of a community, and I do believe what you, it's not exactly socialist, it's not government takeover or anything, but the ability for you to conceive of yourselves at the community level as having interests in common and power, you know, the chance to actually change things, I think that force could be unstoppable if communities grab it. Well, and now, communities, I don't know what I mean, and it could be, you know, some communities are just, they're so big or they're so fragmented they couldn't come together. I come from a very small town. I grew up in a town in Connecticut with about maybe 4,000 people in it, and you know, on Memorial Day, there were 4,000 people on the green. It was governed by town meetings, and you know, hundreds of people showed up and everything. So we acted, I think we acted, not always intelligently, but together, and we could raise questions like you're raising. I think it's possible, and again, I take this city with its heritage and its beauty and its memory, and say, coming together as a community instead of waiting for someone else to fix it.
First, I want to comment on the SNAP benefits in New Bedford and in Dartmouth. There's actually a butcher shop in the South End where you can use SNAP benefits and get fresh meat. And there's a farm in Dartmouth, Silverbrook, Dartmouth. Their farm shares, you can pay with SNAP benefits to get fresh produce. So that leads into my question, which is, when there are opportunities like that around the area that aren't publicized due to, say, the butcher shop not having enough money to advertise it, or the farm not having enough money to advertise that as well, how do you combat a system that feels so overwhelmingly in favor of large corporations who would rather peddle you trash meat for 99 cents than allow you to eat what's right? And how? What's the best way, you think, that we as citizens can kind of stand up against that and fend for ourselves? So,
these are hard questions. I don't have an answer. I'll tell you this. First of all, remember, I'm from the 60s. So, you know, we had a war that was unjust, youth were in the streets.
We know about that.
Yeah, you remember. The civil rights movement, feminism, the environmental movement, they didn't get birthed top down. No. They got birthed with mobilization. And I do believe there's a mobilization need around these progressive values that is the only answer I can see right now compared to waiting for top down progressivism. But you can do it. And so, for example, with respect to the community farming and the, you know, the availability of food, what you need here in New Bedford is an innovation center brought together by the community, which would be a marketplace of really good ideas that everyone should know about. You know, you can wait for it to be in the New York Times or for it to be on CNN, but don't wait. No, you have it here and begin to understand that knowledge is power and you can actually move that around. I would go back to the concept of grassroots. Grassroots change is really, really important. Those corporations are just not going to behave differently right now until they see that the markets have changed and they have to go a different place to be able to make money. And that's where your power is. You know, part of this to me, if I can just say one more word, it sounds a little flaky, but I don't think it's flaky. And that is a vision of the community you want. It's what, draw me a picture, or have your seven-year-olds draw that and draw you a picture of the New Bedford you would like to have. You know, what do you start to write down? Because if you have, as a collective community, solidarity around this idea of the kind of place you are or will be, then you can build it. If there's no collective sense of what you'd like to build, then it's very hard to get everyone on board. But I know my dimensions, and they're largely related to the social justice issues that drive me. But what would you like the health of New Bedford to be? What would you like the degree of mutual respect in your community across boundaries of color and wealth? What would you like it to be? Well, how do you want to move in New Bedford? What should it feel like to be in the place? I think there's something in that I think is pretty important.
I think we're very fortunate that we have a grassroots effort, which is the New Bedford Wellness Initiative. I'm looking at that. And the help of Down to Earth as well. There, you know, I think we're very fortunate that we do have something started. It's just got to pick up a little bit more, you know, with all of us spreading the word that, hey, get on the New Bedford Well Initiative, see what we have going on here. There's a lot of good stuff going on.
What would you need most to accelerate or expand that, do you think? What would help? What would help the most to accelerate or expand that initiative?
I think word of mouth has a lot to do with it too. I mean, I know for Dr. Rocher has his monthly wellness walk. It's attended, but it could be better attended. And I think if we all, those of us who do tend to attend regularly, bring an extra person with us and, you know, spread it on Facebook or whatever else, you know, social media. But it's been going on about a year. You're the better judge of that than I am.
What's your answer to what could fuel it further?
So what we need is everybody on board. Mm-hmm. So right now, the people that are at baseline interested in improving health, we've reached some of them. We need to get to the entire city. We need to get to the politicians. Mm-hmm. We need to get to the city council. We need to get to the administrators of the healthcare organizations in the region. And we need to put some teeth behind the fact that we can be better through lifestyle. Our community, unfortunately, has been identified as the underperformer of the state. For the Tufts study of age over 60, we scored the worst on a collective score for chronic health diseases. And when I saw that come out in the newspaper about a year ago, and unfortunately they're not here tonight either, I said enough is enough. We can't continue to stand back. I grew up in this community. I'm a New Bedford High School grad. I went to public schools here. I take care of a lot of people that I take care of, friends of family, and it's not okay. I can't take people's co-pays. I can't simply hand out pills and procedures. It's not enough. So we actually have to mobilize where every one of us in our community has to come together. There's too much suffering. There really is, and we have to gain the support of the community organizations to make it happen.
The New Bedford has, the type Mike was just talking about, that there aren't solutions invented somewhere in the nation or definitely somewhere in the world. And that idea of curiosity about, you know, just becoming global in your thinking about who's really grappling with this and what are the models we can use. I think there are answers. I really do. I'm sensitive to time. It's 9. Why don't we take 2 more questions, and I'll hang around for a little bit. Yes, you're getting an endorsement.
Oh. Well, my question was, what should the Medicare do about it? But that question has been asked. So maybe I can suggest that we should start figuring out how many people that you would like Dr. Rocha to see this film. Shouldn't all the city council see it? Shouldn't the Board of Health see it? We should figure out who knows who in the community that we can act, will be willing to approach their city council, their representative, really organize for that.
Every person in this room has the power to reach out to more people. This is where the seeds start to be planted. We water those seeds, and we take one step at a time. That's how we do it.
I have 2 connections I can give you right now to take action further. So IHI, the organization that I started and I'm back at as senior fellow now, has a project that I'm helping with, started last year, called 100 Million Healthier Lives. That's the name of the project, 100 Million Healthier Lives. And it is inviting communities and organizations that want to work on what we're talking about to come together and start, learn from each other, celebrate, exchange knowledge, visit each other. And if any of you are interested, maybe just tell Mike and I'll connect you up to that project. That we're waiting for cities and towns that want to really join, and you're perfect for that. The other one, just back to a topic you may not want to talk about, but it is an area of potential progress, and that is care at the end of life, the care of advanced illness. That's really broken. And I don't know the patterns here, Mike would, but there's a wonderful project that Ellen Goodman, the Pulitzer Prize-winning author, has started called the Conversation Project. It's also housed at IHI. You already know, I'm seeing smiles, you know about it? So get on the conversationproject.org. There are entire communities in this country that now have gotten end-of-life care correct. Humane, dignified, person-centered, home-centered, family-centered, under the control of the individual, and they're there. La Crosse, Wisconsin, Salem, Oregon, you can do it too, and that would be another very interesting place to take control of people that really are not getting a fair shake right now, even in communities as compassionate as this one. One more question, and then we'll have to stop. I'm sorry. Yes, sir.
Financial aspect of the process. I had to have an x-ray done at the local hospital, Cape Cod Hospital. And I got, due to insurance foul-ups or whatever you want to describe it as, the billing department screwed up. I got a bill for $200.25. I did some fighting, screaming about who should be paying and what should be done. The end payment was $35.30 from the insurance. Why is there that much of a difference in something as simple as one x-ray?
Welcome to American Healthcare Financing. We built a monstrous system of complexity and coding and negotiations and hidden deals, and it just is a mess. I must say, I'm not one to just say there are evildoers out there. I think everybody's behaving quite rationally the way we built the system. You probably run the insurance company the same way, but it is crazy. And the administrative costs, not to mention your time that no one was billing for, it just is insane. That's why I really think that we need to be thinking about simpler payment systems. In my gubernatorial campaign, I favored the single payer at the state level. It's very hard to do, but we can do it. But even if you don't go there, it's a very obscure area, but we need to begin to pay for populations, for the care of populations. We want to put in Mike Rocha's hands, not, you know, so much money every time he does a procedure, but an amount that he could then bring to the service of the community to help make you all healthier. And that idea of pulling the money together in one pot and then making it accountable to you, the people, so it can be used to generate health and well-being, is I think a very important transformation. We talk about it in the film as moving from volume to outcomes, or volume to value. That's the current rhetoric, but it really has to do with stopping this we pay for healthcare as if buying a car involved a bill in which you have so much for the brakes and so much for the windshield and so much for the door handle. No, you want to buy a car, you want transportation. That's not how we pay for healthcare right now. It drives you crazy, and it wastes untold amounts of money, and we need to have that. I'm going to have to, Mike, give you a
follow-up. Well,
Yes, in the back.
Dr. Burr, thank you. I'll take a minute and just thank Mike. I've had the privilege of working with Mike for the last several years since he came back to town on the commission now. And he's got his heart and soul in this project, and he clearly has brought out the best in a lot of people, even me, which is difficult to do, I might add. But I think we should just take a moment to thank Mike, and then I'll ask you. I grew up in New Bedford as well, and I went to school here through Key Junior High, and then my parents sent me away because I was a bad kid. But I came back, and one of the things that has happened in medicine, I think, is that doctors, over the course of years, who are terrible business people, and terribly organized group of people, gave up the control of healthcare a while ago. And I think we ceded control to the business people, including the insurance companies, who have really mandated what they consider to be good care, irrespective of how physicians feel about it or what we feel is important. So you've been on both sides of the table now, and I'm curious, since we now have a former insurance executive running the state, how you feel we should take on, or how you feel physicians can get control back, and in turn, by empowering physicians to actually do the job that they'd like to do, that would obviously be a benefit to the community.
Yeah, well, thanks. I've been writing quite a bit about this lately. Let me give you a quick answer. So, the physicians have not always worn the angel's wings on this. The American Medical Association opposed the introduction of Medicare. Their main concern over the past few years in healthcare reform has been SGR, the amount they get paid, not patient safety or, physicians have not always acted as a body, as a guild in the direction this film is pushing. But as individual doctors, people really do want to heal. That's why most of them are there. And I must say, don't forget the nurses. There are more than the doctors, and they're probably more central to the way the healthcare system functions. But clinicians care. My view is this. I think there is an empty chair that the professions could occupy, and it's the chair of leading change. Because to say that I'm a doctor and I want my power back so that we can keep things as they are is not responsive. The AAA matters. And so if the medical community of New Bedford were to say, we're going to deliver the AAA in New Bedford, we're going to have better care, better health, and lower cost per capita so the workers can have the money back, the chair's empty. That would be real leadership. That, to me, would be the way out of the mess. I call that change from the inside out and change instead of change from the outside in. And I think it's possible. But it's not physicians defending physicians. It's physicians defending the social need, which is better care, better health, and lower cost. And I would love to see that kind of aggregate action begin. We're past the time. I'll tell you what, I'll stay here a few more minutes. I've got to get home too, but I'm happy to stay to answer your questions. Let me just thank Mike and thank you for the chance to visit with you.